great to have you back with us at GoldSeek.com Radio for another Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Gerald Celente from the Trends Research Institute. Gerald Celente, director of the Trends Research Institute, his team has the Trends Journal, and they've got another big, hard-hitting, in-depth report out. Welcome back, Gerald Celente.
Well, thanks for having me.
Want to see the end to the madness. Cover story. I don't know about you. I want to see the end of the madness. How are we going to see the end of global warfare? You know, I thought that the First World War, the war to end all wars, I don't think that moniker stuck, did it? The next go-round, we ended up with a nuclear age, right? But it didn't end warfare. It was supposed to end all of war ad infinitum. It didn't work. Tell us how we're going to see the end of this madness, or are we?
Well, we're going to do our part to make it happen. And on May 2nd, 2015, from the most historic crossroads in the United States, the only crossroads where on each corner there's a pre-Revolutionary War stone building where the seeds of democracy was sown, we're launching OccupyPeace.us. This is only for the United States. And it's based upon the principles from Colonial Kingston, New York, that the Founding Fathers set forth in founding this country. And that is no foreign entanglements. And people say, well, you know, it was a different world back then. No, it wasn't. The world was at war back then, too. And when you listen to Madison, Jefferson, Franklin, or a real commander-in-chief, George Washington, at his farewell address, not these little boys that play commander-in-chief, that play golf, basketball, drive pickup trucks, and maybe play a game of cricket. You know, these aren't warriors. George Washington's farewell address, a man that led the troops, led the revolution, no foreign entanglements. So our basis of this movement is to bring home all the troops, self-defense. I'm a close combat practitioner, have been for over 25 years. I'm not a pacifist. I believe in protecting myself. I don't believe in attacking anybody who doesn't bother me. But if I go into somebody else's house and I start something, if they retaliate, you know, don't call me, you know, don't call them a terrorist. Call them getting even. So the Founding Fathers, trade with everyone that you'd like with, but don't get involved in their internal affairs. And this is a program to rebuild America, to use the tens of trillions, that's right, tens of trillions that have been spent since the end of the Cold War, and putting that money back to use into rebuilding America. How many more failures? How many more failures do people have to add up before they can call it what it is? And they can always make excuses as to why the failures happen. Here's one for you. The Korean War, a failure. Vietnam. Well, you know, if you let us bomb them more, hey, you weren't happy killing 3 million and poisoning the entire joint with Agent Orange? How about Iraq? Well, we never should have pulled out. You never should have went there in the beginning. It was based on false information. In the real world, they call them lies. Saddam Hussein did not have weapons of mass destruction and ties to Al-Qaeda. How about Afghanistan, the longest war in American history? You pick up this week's New York Times, listen to what's going on over there in the UK. The generals in charge are saying, well, maybe we didn't get it right. The English are saying, yeah, no kidding. You didn't get it right the other time either, and neither did Alexander the Great, and neither did the Russians. And you guys are in there for 13 years, and now the Taliban are taking over the provinces where the troops are withdrawing from. So that's what our program is. And we're not, this isn't a peace rally. This is a fight for peace, because I would rather fight for peace than die for war. And it's not going to be one of those things where everybody chants, yay, yay, rah, rah, and then goes home. This is going to be takeaways. This is what we do to get we the people to decide the future of this country, not politicians that have sold us out for the military-industrial complex that General Dwight D. Eisenhower, five-star general, supreme commander of the Allied forces, no major wars were fought under his presidency. He warned us about. The military-industrial complex has taken over the nation, and now you could put onto that the cybersecurity-industrial complex.
War, and it is a self-preservation technique. It cannot be a stratagem used to line the pockets of corporate interests. It must only be used as a last measure to defend country and your borders. That being said, I mean, we all know we've got to defend our country.
And what I'm saying about bringing the troops home, self-defense, close the borders, lock them down. And all of this baloney, you know, they keep stealing our rights from us under the guise that they're going to protect us. And let's get this straight. They couldn't stop a guy from jumping over the White House fence, running inside. What, did he make himself a cup of tea, take a shower in there? I mean, stop with the baloney. You know, as Benjamin Franklin said, they that can give up essential liberty to obtain a little temporary safety deserve neither safety nor liberty.
And this is where I think you can really bring some perspective to the dialogue today. If we just kind of went back to World War I, World War II, we were no major military power. You might recall that it took incredible rallying power of our local industry, particularly our auto industry, aircraft industries, to get us into shape. I mean, we were just a out of shape militarily speaking. The world looked to the United States at the end of World War II as this nation that still had it right. And you could come to the United States and you find the American dream.
And this is why we're doing what we're doing. You talk about World War I, every historian knows, a totally, totally avoidable war. Right. And then it kept on going. You know, if there's six words that have destroyed America, I believe I can sum them up. Harvard, Princeton, Yale, bullets, bombs, and banks. A bunch of arrogant guys and girls who think they know better than us because they were born on third base, thought they hit a triple, and they're in the club. And I'll give you the example of it. This man, in my belief, in looking at the founding fathers, and that's Woodrow Wilson, the president of Princeton before he became president of the United States. He's the man that the war was ready to end in Europe. They were bankrupt. They were busted. It was over. He was the one that got us into these foreign entanglements at the level he did. And he also sold out the nation with the Federal Reserve. He was the biggest traitor to America. Harvard, Princeton, Yale, go down the list. Obama, Bush, Clinton. It's the same destructive club that are destroying the greatness of this country. As you well pointed out, the land of opportunity. We did a lot of terrible things in this country, but who in their life doesn't? But we also did a lot of great things in this nation that made us the beacon of freedom. Look, Obama is bombing Syria. They're bombing Syria. Against the Constitution, the Phony Wars Powers Act doesn't even make a play in it. And, hey, who's going to win the World Series? Hey, you think the Kardashians could come back?
It is comical, isn't it? I mean,
it's disgusting.
You know, maybe we're getting the leaders that we deserve. I mean, it's been said that the people elect folks that reflect them the closest.
Well, here's my campaign slogan for the midterm elections. Republicans, Democrats, Bloods the Crips. Which gang of murderers and thieves are you going to vote for? And they're murderers and thieves. How many more millions do the Democrats and Republicans have to murder in the name of liberty and justice around the world? And how much more of our money do they have to steal from us in names of too big to fail, special tax breaks for their corporate friends, and inside deals?
It's a tired cliche, I think, to even bring up Orwell. He's almost a caricature now, I guess, for a cliche, but it's just so appropriate. In 1984, it's almost like it is their guidebook for the powers that be, for our handlers, for our owners, to simply set the stage for complete lockdown control. War is peace. Peace is war. We've really covered this topic, and I'd like to get to another Trends Journal issue, and that's artificial intelligence. You're taking an interesting stance on this.
You know, as we look at it, it's artificial intelligence in one way, but the artificial intelligence is also becoming the way of the world. We're doing another story and a follow-up to that. We're calling it The Walking Dead. Look at every way you look. People are walking, they're either texting, they have earbuds in their ears, they're talking, they're drinking these big 32-ounce gulps of whatever they got in these plastic cups, yeah, toxic sludge, or they're eating. So as we're going into the so-called information age, it's becoming easier and easier to sell people through technology. They're controlled. You know, I was reading a story in the New York Times on a Sunday. It was Arianna Huffington and Kobe Bryant, one of these things, a basketball player. And I'm not into either of them, but I just wanted to read it to see where they were coming from. And the guy that's asking the question says words to the effect, well, all Americans are addicted to their cell phones. How about you? And I said, I don't have one. It's becoming the intelligence. That's what's becoming the realm of where we're going and where we've been, in the sense that there is no such thing as effective multitasking. I don't care what anybody says. I've read enough studies on it. And if you believe it does, there is such a thing. The next time you go to the dentist, if you have an important surgery to have, make sure your doctor or dentist is doing three or four or five other things as he's working on you or she's working on you, and then tell me how great multitasking.
Texting while driving, there's a big groundswell against it, several web pages popping up warning. We hear horror story after horror story because on average it requires 5 seconds of looking away from your driving, and you know how much can happen in 5 seconds, split second, exactly, because it takes so much time just for the mind to recognize that something has happened and for the foot to apply the brakes.
So when we're looking at this story, this artificial intelligence, it goes back to what you said about Orwell. It's almost become a cliche.
We're waiting for Skynet, right, from the Terminator movies. I mean, when decades ahead of their time with much of Arnold's movies there. So, I mean, I think you make a great point. But then there's, you know, the flip side. You show some fantastic opportunities that are coming up as a result of artificial intelligence. For instance, treating autistic children. You know, this is a traditionally intensive process. There are people who have withdrawn into their minds, most likely due to damage coming from toxins, sadly, within immunization as well as from other external stimuli, and some of it is genetic as well. But there are some fantastic treatments that you outline, and I'm sure we're going to see some more treatments for Alzheimer's folks, therapies that stem from artificial intelligence. It's just like everything else in technology, isn't it? Technology has that Janus-like two sides to it.
Oh, absolutely. You know, you really hit it on the nail on the head. No, there are the positives as well, and many of them. I mean, look, our lives have changed so much because of the better elements of technology. The internet is the Alexandrian Library 2.0. You know, anybody that wants to seek out information is there for everyone. And with the artificial intelligence going into new levels of development and creativity, it could have wonderful, wonderful applications.
I think we've covered a few of the bases on a brief show today. What have I left out that you'd like to leave with the listening audience?
Global markets. And again, it's all tied together as well. You know, you're looking at destabilization in the Middle East to levels we haven't seen in years. And then, of course, the Ukraine crisis is still going on. And very important, oil prices. And this is another issue we cover, you know, quite in depth in the Trends Journal. I've been watching this start to unravel when oil hit, Brent crude hit $115 a barrel in June. This is a demand issue. Yes, there's a lot of supply. There's no question about it. But it's more of a demand issue. And demand is way down in China. Right now, there's certain kinds of iron products, rebar, for example. In China, a ton of rebar is cheaper than a ton of cabbage. That's how much excess commodity product is out there. So what this is signaling is a global slowdown. And I believe, in going back to gold, that you're going to see, and they're already talking about it, you're going to see new methods of stimulation to juice the sagging economies. And when that happens, that's when we're forecasting the next gold bull run. So here we are, we're looking at gold, you know, fluctuating a little over and above $1,200 an ounce. When gold breaks 1475, that's our magic number for the next gold bull run. The downside of gold, and again, we're not, as you well know, you look at the Trends Journal, advertising free. Nobody tells us what to do. We don't take money from advertisers for that issue of the Trends Journal. We're going to be issuing a Trends Journal monthly, which is different, but no gold advertisers, what I'm saying, and we don't get any money from any gold groups or anyone. So we're just saying this is our forecast, and that is the downside of gold is $100 to $150. We don't see it going below that, but the upside is much, much greater, and particularly with what's going on now. And as I said, we're launching Occupy Peace. Einstein's prophecy that I don't know how the Third World War will be fought, but the Fourth will be fought with sticks and stones, doesn't happen. Because as I was mentioning earlier, the First World War, as you had mentioned, this is really, and going over with Churchill and others, the First World War has set the whole stage for the destruction that's going on now in the Middle East when it was carved up by the colonial powers following the war. No more to war. To me, peace is patriotic.
And we're certainly on board with you with regard to the yellow metal. Very solid support around 1170. It's held up 4 years. And should it break, yeah, well, you might see a retest of the $900 to $1,000 area. Technically speaking, once we get up there to your $1,400 zone, I think that's when the shorts start to cover and the momentum enters into the market. And then folks start to get all concerned about, have I missed the bottom and the next bull run? So it all sounds like great advice. Our listeners are going to appreciate that. Gerald Celente, Trends Journal Institute. We really appreciate you.
Thank you so much for having me, Chris.